just have to somehow get access into this one here and change out the network card. And my problem is I kind of blocked the front side of the server shelf somehow. Currently, because it's winter outside and it's snowing and raining, I can't pull the server off the other side if I don't move a lot of things. So I'm gonna have to try and access it from this side. Okay, that wasn't any fun. I had to move all the stuff out of the front. It was jamming, the cover was jamming, and I don't know what it was jamming on. Technically speaking, it should have come off. Anyway, now we've got inside, so I'm just going to... Yeah, just and just. Well, that has the RAID controller built into it. So I have to be careful with this one. I have no idea how I'm... I mean, I have made a video of adding a network card, so, because I don't really know if I'm really going to be able to film this. It's already very tight. So anyway, I suggest you go watch the video about the installing this card. So I hope you all remember to put the label in there. So far so good. Now I have to get the lid on and the camera's standing on the lid. So I have to move the camera out of the way. Oh, I got it through. That was not easy. Wish it was summer. The door. Okay. So I'm hoping that like the server above it's still running okay. I suppose the idea is to connect the minimum to this one and then see that it hasn't been, it hasn't broken. Well, I think I'll put a module in and just plug it in and just to see what happens. I'd like to plug in the monitor. At least we get, this has a bad habit of when it's doing the, I think it's the BIOS boot up that sometimes, but rarely, it locks up in a loop. So it does the, if I remember correctly, it boots to the same place, to the same location, and then you have to power it, power cycle it to get it to work up properly. You pull the plug and then you let it power down completely and then you plug it in again. And then it's mysteriously works again. Anyway, I have no idea if the drivers, if there are drivers for this card or not pre-installed, so I'm just taking a chance. The power button. These servers are a bit interesting because there's no logic, or there probably is some, but sometimes when you probably in the ILO configuration or something, because sometimes when you plug in the cable, the power cable, it'll automatically switch on, and sometimes it won't. through my collection of multi-mode SFP modules. And hooray! None of them work! So, in desperation, I switched to single mode fiber, which is the connection that's been working best for me. And there's a green light, and
what do you get? Green light down there, also. Oh, wait, gone.
I don't know what it is with me and multi-mode modules, but I should have the correct patch table. And the Cisco end is recognized. It recognizes this multi-mode SFP module just fine.
But all the multi-mode
SFP modules that I tried to plug into this card didn't work. But as soon as I plugged in the single mode, which actually has a Cisco single mode SFP module on, then it just activated. So anyway, so now I just have to go check and see if I got an IP address on this traffic. Well, again, okay, so I have to buy more single mode modules. Cisco single mode module. It seemed to work for me. If my memory failed me. Two single mode modules. Just nine there. I was sure I bought three. So anyway, now I'm not going to touch that server. That's connected. We have the connection to the long distance fiber. Now I'm going to just reconnect this server to the Windows server, and that's going to work.
Cisco
seems to accept it all. So that's perfect. So that's done. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video. Bit of a struggle, but like I said, that's my track record of multi-mode modules is very bad. I don't know. The only thing I could think of is that my patch cables are of the wrong type, but there really isn't that many types of multi-mode patch cables. So power coding wise and stuff, they should be correct. Yeah. But also my equipment has been showing they don't accept the modules either. It's not only been the issue with the patch cable, it's been that for example, the Cisco module, the Cisco unit doesn't accept them, so when you so it should be yellow color, and when you plug in a module that it recognizes, then it goes black, and then when you connect in the fiber and you get the link, then you get green. And it hasn't been happening. Whew. Anyway, job done. So, hi, me again. Turns out even if it's very much blinky-blinky, then we don't get any connections. So I thought I'd show you a little bit of what I did on the on the server to identify how to fix it. And now we can be in a little bit more quieter environment, so I don't have to be in the data centers. I have a remote connection through an existing 1 gig network interface. Actually, there's four of them on the servers. So we're using that, and then we're going to diagnose the 10 gig connection. So anyway, let's have a look at some of the commands. So, So anyway, the first command I used was to see if we can find the card on the PCI bus. So this is just basically, it says list all the PCI devices that have been found, and then list all those lines that have Mellanox in the name. So we see we have a Ethernet controller Mellanox technology, and it's a ConnectX 3 Pro version. So okay, so far so good. And since we saw blinky blink, then obviously something's alive. So let's take it to another level. We have this command, and this is going to say it's going to use this mstconfig utility to list the config information on that specific PCI device. So here we get a very raw type of config info list, but it shows you what the configurations are, what the outcome of from the next boot will be. But mainly this is to run to see that it can actually access the config information on the card, and because that's a good indicator that quite a lot of communication is already established. So, and then we take the command to list basically all interfaces that are IP capable on them and defined on the machine. And here we get a list of interfaces, and these ENO 1 to 4 are the existing ones. So that's the 4 1 gigabit network interfaces that are on the motherboard of the SERP. And then you actually can see the card is the ENS1, and then basically the module or the sub module, because it's got two places, then it's ENS1D1. And then we can also see here that the interface is down, so it's not active. So pull up the Ethernet tool level information for that interface, so you can see it a little bit more clear text. So here we see that we don't have any link, and speed seems to be correct. Full duplex is defined. And this was the little bit funny thing that I don't know if if I set the speed manually or did it set it automatically itself. That's still a contention of confusion. But I can show you the command that you can actually at least configure the speed, and so you can use this command. You can actually use this command, even though in my opinion it actually didn't change anything. You can set the speed and the auto negotiation to off, and also the ethtool you could set the full duplex. But as I said, I'm not sure if I actually saw any difference by executing that command. So anyway, so what we now have is we have basically an interface that's down, and then we will have just to go to an even higher level. We use the ifconfig to see all the defined interfaces that are active. And here we have the loopback device, and then we have I have Docker installed, so there's a Docker interface, and then there's the 4 existing Ethernet ports. And as you see, one of them is active, so that's how I'm actually maintaining a console session. So what I did was that is that I activated the interface just to see if it could be activated. So that's this manual operation. So we take this one, and I just said that, oh well, what the heck, I'll try and activate that interface since it's down, so I'll try and make it up. And then we'll try the R again, just to check what's happened. Ah! Looks like the ENS1D1 is now in status up, but it still has no IP address. And of course, I mean, this is a server, so you know, many like to configure servers with permanent IP addresses, and I should probably do that too. But now I have it using basically I can use DHCP. So I'm going to force the DHCP client on the server to renew all the DHCP addresses. And let's see what happens. Oh, there we go. And then after I've done that, we can recheck. So here we go. And aha! Looks like the ENS1D1 has a valid IP address now. And then when we take ifconfig, ah, look, the interface has now popped up in the active IP interface list, and it actually has a valid IP address. So for my subnet networks, that's valid. And as I said, many like to have static IP address. Now, the only thing is that if I reboot this machine, then I'll end up in the same situation. The interface will be down, and it has no DHCP assigned IP address. So what I will demonstrate now is how to make this initialization permanent. And I mean, I have tested, as you see, there's already a small amount of traffic going on. I've tested this is valid and it works. So after I've done those steps, then this interface is stable. As long as I don't reboot the server, if I reboot the server, then the interface goes down and it has no IP address. So anyway, let's have a look at the configuration. So let's have a look at this configuration. And wasn't that bad actually. So, how can I explain? Okay, so this Ubuntu server installation uses a network configuration platform shell called Netplan. And basically, the information I found is that if you add an interface like I've done and it's DHCP configured, it will not be activated and assigned a DHCP address if you do not specifically declare it. The way you do it is that, without going into excruciating amount of details, that you need to edit the netplan YAML file. And I did that and rebooted, and as you see, I have, without doing any manual steps, I have the interfaces up and the IP addresses configured. So let's have a look at the YAML file. So now we're in the YAML file, and this has obviously been generated when I installed the server, so I haven't added any interfaces. So what I did is that I just added the interface here. So, and if you're going to use fixed IP static addresses, you can actually enter the parameters here to statically assign the both the IP address, default gateway, DNS server, all that stuff. So it's basically, there's a certain syntax you use to put each configuration item on its own line under the section for the interface. And then it will just, if I understand, what happens is that then when you reboot the server, then the netplan infrastructure reads this config file and then automatically generates the script file configurations and setups for all the network like daemons and stuff that need to actually do the work. So as I understood it, this is like a abstraction layer on for network configuration, so that you don't have to understand all the details of every. Because there are, of course, on different distributions, there are different infrastructures for handling, you know, bringing an interface up and assigning it an IP address or using DHCP. But anyway, this seemed to work fine, so basically, yeah, it's done. So I rebooted the computer twice and then I didn't lose the interface, so I think it's pretty much done. So, hope you found this useful. If it was, then consider buying me a cup of coffee. It makes it more easier to stay up late solving problems. And merch is also available. The links are in the description. I've also added in the description, I've added the commands that I used and yeah, some URLs that might be of interest for general information. So, yeah. Well, anyway, 10 gig. Fixed. Fantastic. See you in the next one.